Hello everybody, welcome back. In this video, I want to show you examples of solutions of the linearized field equations. These solutions are somewhat special because they correspond to symmetries of the causal fermion systems, or in other words, they correspond to the fact that the causal fermion system is invariant under certain transformations. Well, this has two purposes. First of all, it is good for you to get familiar with the linearized field equations. You see a little bit how this works. And moreover, these solutions will be important later on in the context of surface layer integrals and Noether-like theorems. The setting we consider here is again that of causal variational principles. So therefore, curly F is again a smooth manifold. And we assume that rho is a solution of the Euler-Lagrange equation. And then the linearized field equation look as follows. Let me write them down again. So this is Nabla U integral over M Nabla 1 V plus Nabla 2 V acting on the Lagrangian d rho y minus Nabla v s is equal to 0, and this should hold for all test jets u, so for all u in a certain test space j test. Good, maybe before constructing the solutions, I should make a few remarks just for clarity. I mean, in the last video, I said that we use the convention that all these derivatives act only on the Lagrangian, which means that this means more specifically that this jet is not differentiated and this jet is not differentiated. Well, and for those of you who come from differential geometry, you might wonder, well, but if we take second derivatives, this cannot be done in an invariant way. One needs to introduce a covariant derivative. Well, and there are several ways to deal with this. One possibility would, in fact, to introduce a covariant derivative on curly F, a connection on curly F, and then to consider the derivatives here as covariant derivatives. This is something one can do, but the disadvantage is one has to introduce the connection. And we felt that this is a bit more than what we actually need. I mean, so in order to keep things simple, our procedure is that we work here with partial derivatives, but we always choose specific charts. So we work in special charts. In fact, for causal fermion systems, these are the so-called symmetric wave charts, and working in this specific charts, also higher partial derivatives are well defined, and that's what we are working with here. Another point of view, and that's mainly what we'll do here in this online course, is to note that the terms, when V here is differentiated, drop out anyhow if we use the Euler-Lagrange equations. And this, well, this is a fair point of view, so if one takes this point of view, one doesn't need to worry here. However, this can be done only, at least like with a good conscience, in the smooth setting. Because otherwise one needs to make sure that whatever the derivative of V in direction of U is again a jet in J test, and then things get a little bit subtle. Okay, but as I already mentioned, I mean, in this course, I don't want to focus on this non-smoothness and things are differentiable only in certain directions, because I think that in the first step, like the first learning process, it's good to simplify things a little bit and to assume that everything is smooth. And with this in mind, also, I don't need to introduce a covariant derivative here. Okay. Now, let us construct the solutions of the linearized field equations. And as I already said at the beginning, these solutions correspond to certain invariances of the setup here. And one invariance is unitary invariance, but of course this works only for causal fermion systems, so not for causal variational principles in general, because then it's not clear, well, what should this unitary group be? So therefore, let me write here unitary invariance for causal fermion systems. Okay, and let's consider the finite dimensional case for technical simplicity. So the dimension of the Hilbert space is finite, and then the set curly F should be more precisely the set F rec C. So all symmetric linear operators of rank 2n, which have n positive and n negative eigenvalues, and trace C. This is a manifold. And now we can unitarily transform the operators in this manifold. So we do this more precisely as follows. So we choose an operator A, linear operator on the Hilbert space, which is symmetric or self-adjoint, which of course in the finite dimensional setting is the same. Good, so then we introduce a family of unitary operators U sub T defined by e to the I T A. So this is a family of unitary transformations. Now suppose we take a point X in curly F. Then we can transform it. So namely what we do is we say, well, f t of x, so this is defined by u t e to the I t a, e to u t x u t to the minus 1. Okay, and this gives a curve in curly f. Maybe I should draw this here. Now let me just draw curly F like this. Well, then we have M, this is a subset here, so the space-time doesn't need to be smooth, so let me just draw it like this. It could also consist of discrete points, so this is M. And now we take a point X, which could be on M, but doesn't necessarily need to be, so this is the point X. Well, and then F T of x gives me here a certain curve. So this is f t of x. Of course, if I set t equal to 0, I get the point x. Also, what is clear is that all these operators here are again in curly f because they are all symmetric. Also, the rank and the number of positive and negative eigenvalues doesn't change if you unitarily transform. So therefore, this really gives a smooth curve here in curly F. If we differentiate with respect to T, so then we get a tangent vector to this curve. Let me just draw it like this. So this is this is what I denote by V. So V of X, this you can also write it like this, F dot 0 of X. This is the tangent vector. Let's compute this in more detail. So this means here V of X defined by dt f t of X. Well, of course, now we have to differentiate the unitary transformation here, which just gives us a factor of ia down. And of course, the inverse is e to the minus ita, then we get a minus ia down. So therefore, what we get here is I times the commutator of A, comma X. Then, of course, at t equal to 0. So this is what is called a commutator vector field. Which means this, given the operator A, I get a vector field on all of curly F. Let me just draw it like this. And sometimes we also denote this by CA of X for commutator vector field generated by the linear operator A. So this is the same as I times A comma X. Good. Then of course, restricting this vector field to M, we get a vector field on curly F along M. Let's just do it like this. So we say that this V or CA, we didn't say V of X defined by CA of X with X in M is a vector field in gamma of M TF. Good, now we construct the corresponding jet. Jet means that we also need to specify a scalar component. Well, in this case, the scalar component is zero. So this is zero comma V. This is the commutator jet. Okay. Now the symmetry invariance, what does all this mean? So we know that the Lagrangian is unitarily invariant. So this means if we unitarily transform both arguments, then the Lagrangian does not change. So L of Ft of x, Ft of y is the same as L of x comma y. Well, this is kind of obvious because the Lagrangian is computed from the eigenvalues of these operator products, but the eigenvalues are, of course, do not change if we unitarily transform the operator. So therefore, this is kind of obvious from the basic definitions. Good, and maybe I should say right here L kappa. I mean, you should keep in mind we always have this boundedness constraint built in, so the L is always L kappa, but as I said, we want to keep the notation simple. I don't write this out. And of course, the boundedness constraint is also unitarily invariant. So therefore, this is kind of the symmetry we have. So the Lagrangian is symmetric under unitary transformations, or unchanged, invariant under unitary transformations. Good, now the point is that this also gives rise to a corresponding solutions of the linearized field equations, namely these commutator jets here are solutions. This is somehow not so surprising if you think of how the linearized field equations were constructed. Then one can argue as follows. Suppose so we start from a critical measure. If we unitarily transform this measure, it will remain critical because everything is unitarily invariant. So therefore, with this family of unitary transformations generates a family of critical measures. Well, and this was precisely the starting point for the construction of the linearized field equations. In other words, the infinitesimal generator of this transformation should then be a solution of the linearized field equations. Well, and of course, the infinitesimal generator, these are precisely these commutator jets. Good, but let's also verify more like by direct computation that this commutator jet is in fact a solution of the linearized field equations. And to this end, well, first of all, maybe I should state it as a lemma. So the commutator jet of for any symmetric A in L of H, the corresponding commutator jet. Satisfies the linearized field equations. And I do not need to even specify what the test jets are. So let me, you'll see in the proof how this goes. Okay, so our starting point is of course this equation here, and now we differentiate with respect to time. So if you take d by dt, L of f tau of x, f tau of y at t, well, then this corresponds, of course, like with the product rule, we have to differentiate here, we have to differentiate here. Each derivative just corresponds to the jet derivative with the corresponding commutator jet. So this is the same as nabla 1v plus nabla 2v acting on the Lagrangian. Okay, so good. Moreover, what about this term nabla vs? Well, s is a constant, so therefore this jet derivative, we only get the contribution from the scalar component, but this is equal to zero, because v has no scalar component. Okay, so now we use that. So I mean, this is equal to zero. Okay, so therefore what we can write down, we know that nabla 1v plus nabla 2v L of xy. So this is equal to zero. And of course, if we integrate this over y, this is also zero. Now, if we subtract this nabla vs, well, this is also zero. So therefore, what we have here is equal to zero. Well, in fact, for any x, for all x in curly F, so we do not need to evaluate on M, so we can take any point in F, and this is zero. And therefore, the derivative exists and is also zero. So therefore, nabla U of this expression, maybe I just copy it here, so this is also zero. Okay, and therefore the linearized field equations hold. Good, so these were the commutator jets and the underlying symmetries, unitary invariants. Now let's come to another invariance, namely diffeomorphism invariance of M. And let me explain this a little bit. Of M. Well, this kind of generalizes the diffeomorphism invariance which you have, for example, in general relativity. So in this case, M is a manifold. You can choose any charts. You can perform diffeomorphisms of space-time, and the equations remain unchanged. Here, the situation is, so we want to do something similar. So if we perform a diffeomorphism, just denoted by phi tau, M to M, a family of diffeomorphisms. Of course, with phi 0 is equal to the identity. Good, so where then, first of all, what is the infinitesimal generator? This will then again be a vector field, but now a vector field in M. So now the picture is, if I draw the same picture as earlier, suppose we have now here M. Well, then this phi tau maps M to itself. So therefore, the infinitesimal generator will be a vector field which lies here. That's denoted by V. So V of x defined by d tau phi tau of x at tau equal to 0. So this is now an infinitesimal generator of, so this is like infinitesimal generator, and this should be a vector field on M. Good, and now we can also perform the measure. So if one performs the measure, so if one takes phi tau star rho, say, okay, maybe we could call this here rho tilde tau if we liked. Well, then this measure will in general change. I mean, if this phi tau is a volume-preserving diffeomorphism, then the measure remains unchanged. But in general, it will change. And infinitesimally, the measure changes by the divergence of the vector field V. The change of the measure is described infinitesimally. By the divergence of V. I mean, one can think of this, well, intuitively as in physics, that you have like a flow and then kind of the density changes according to how much flows in minus what flows out, when this is always what is given by the divergence of the vector field. And well, in the same is with the measure. I mean, you can think of the measure as a density which is like floating around as described by this vector field. And then the change of the density or the change of the measure is again described by the divergence. And of course, we'll see this in more detail soon. So this was more just a motivation here. Okay, so this is like there's a certain invariance here or with a certain transformation, and we know how things transform. And as we shall see, this again gives rise to a solution of the linearized field equation. And well, the way you can think about it is, suppose you describe M by coordinates, then this diffeomorphism can be understood as a change of coordinates. And the causal action principle, it does not depend on the choice of coordinates, it's defined independent. And this is the reason why there's a underlying symmetry, which corresponds to the diffeomorphism invariance, and that there's also a corresponding solution of the linearized field equations. Okay, so far for the motivation. Now let's make all this more precise. And there are points which I need to clarify. Namely, first of all, I mean, what does it mean to be a vector field on M? What is the divergence of a vector field? This is not clear in general. In particular, if this M is non-smooth, I mean, the situation we had here, suppose M has here discrete components, is non-smooth, then what should be the divergence of a vector field be? This is not clear. So therefore, for this diffeomorphism invariance, we need additional assumption on the structure of space-time. And they called that space-time has a smooth manifold structure. So at least that's sufficient for our purposes. So now here we assume that, well, I mean, curly F has a smooth manifold structure anyhow, but now we assume that also the support of the measure is a smooth manifold, say four-dimensional, for example. And Then, moreover, we assume that, the measure is, so the measure rho is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure on this manifold. And once we make these assumptions, then the divergence here is well defined, and then we can also prove that we get solution of the Linear field equations. Okay, and I want to point out that this is really like a major simplification, and it's not justified in any way. I mean, if you take a really minimizer of the causal action principle, there's no reason to assume that it's smooth. In fact, there are results which indicate that the minimizing measure should be discrete. Nevertheless, so the picture is that this discreteness is something which comes into play on very small scales, say on the Planck scale. But if you look at space-time on a large scale, like the space-time which we usually experience, then it's in very good approximation a smooth manifold. And this is kind of what we are using here. So the picture is, well, the measure might well be discrete, but nevertheless, in many applications, it's a fair simplification to describe it by a smooth, by a space-time with a smooth manifold structure. Good, so now let me first of all define this. So space-time M, which is of course again the support of the measure, has a smooth manifold structure. If the following conditions hold, namely first, that M is say k-dimensional smooth manifold. Of course, a submanifold, maybe I should better have written submanifold of curly F, which is a bit more, because also the embedding should be smooth. Smooth submanifold of curly F. And then the second assumption in a chart of, say, we choose coordinates xi, whatever defined on u, of m, the measure rho can be written as d rho is equal to a function h of x dk x. So this means that it can be written as the Lebesgue measure in the chart multiplied by a function h of x, which we assume to be smooth, with h a smooth function on the domain of the chart. Okay, and of course it's smooth, well, of course, then it's a positive function, a smooth positive function. Good, I should say that, well, now if one transforms the charts, so if one goes over from one chart to another, well, then this function h here, of course, changes, namely changes like a density. So therefore, but of course the assumption here just it's smooth, and it's smooth no matter which chart you choose, because our atlas is smooth because we have a smooth submanifold. Okay, so these are the assumptions. Well, and under these assumptions, we can of course say what it means for a vector field to be smooth. So this means let V in gamma MTM be a vector field on M. And this is now really tangential to space-time. Or in other words, we can also consider this as a vector field in curly F along M, but moreover it is tangential. So this means that V of X is equal in TXM, which is the linear subspace of TX curly F. Okay, so this is the setting, but now we can work intrinsically in M in space-time, and we can also form the divergence, namely how can the divergence be defined? And this is maybe not quite straightforward because we have no Riemannian metric. But the way to do it is as follows. Let me first of all write down the formula. So divergence of V is 1 over H times DI of H times VI of X. So you can just compute it like this in a chart, and this is in fact independent of the choice of charts. Defined by this is independent and this is of course something you can verify by direct computation, but there's also a more direct way of understanding this, namely for the on a Riemannian manifold there's a formula for the divergence, so this Kusul formula, which tells you here 1 over square root of the determinant of G times DI of square root of the determinant of G times VI. So this is the usual formula on a Riemannian manifold. Well, and somehow the function H here plays the same role as the square root of the determinant of G on a Riemannian manifold. And it has the same transformation behavior. So because the volume measure on a Riemannian manifold can be written in coordinates like this, and this function h of x is just the square root of the determinant of the Riemannian metric. So therefore, this formula can be understood as a direct generalization of the Kusul formula, noting that we don't really need a metric for this formula, but it suffices to have a density, namely function like this h of x is sufficient. Independent of the choice of charts, this can be seen in analogy to the Kusul formula. In Riemannian geometry. Where, well then this whatever the d mu m is square root of the determinant of g times dk x. Good. Now let's form the what is the resulting jet, and the jet is formed by also taking the diverted vector field and its divergence. The jet, so the first the scalar component is the divergence, and then we take the vector field is the so-called inner solution. Is a so-called inner solution. Of course, there are many of them. Every smooth vector field gives rise to an inner solution. Inner solution. Well, where does the name come from? Well, inner, because it corresponds to a transformation of space-time within space-time. It's not a transformation which leaves space-time, so which takes place in curly F. This is something which takes place purely in M in space-time, therefore it's inner solution which doesn't leave our space-time. Inner solution, because it's a solution of the linearized field equations, and let me now state and prove this. So the statement is that V, of course, then we denote this by V, is a solution of the linearized field equations . Okay, and I want to prove this first of all in a simple case that the vector field has compact support. If V is in gamma 0 of MTM has compact support. Well then, if the I'll make a remark on what happens in the case when the vector field does not have compact support later. But let's first of all consider this simpler case. Okay, so first of all, what we do is, of course, we need to integrate by parts, and then it turns out that this inner solution completely drops out. Let me explain this. Suppose we take a function which is smooth and compact, has compact support on M, say, real valued. Okay, then we integrate over M. The dv f, so just the directional derivative, and we integrate with respect to rho. Good, now we put in what rho is, so this is the integral over m dv f times h of x, but everything depends here on x, of course, times, and now the just the k-dimensional Lebesgue measure. Now we can integrate by parts or apply Gauss' theorem, and V has compact support. This is why we do not get boundary terms. Also, F has here compact support. In fact, we don't even need this because the vector field already has compact support. So we get no boundary terms, and then what we get is minus the integral over M. And then maybe I write this in components. So let's write this as vi di f. And then integrating by parts, where then the f is no longer differentiated. But then we have di of h times f dk h times vi, of course, h times vi dkx. So this is how it looks like. Okay, just the derivative acts on all the other functions. Good, and now in order to get back to the volume measure d rho, so we multiply here by h and then we divide here by h, and then we see, okay, this is precisely the divergence of v. This is d rho, so therefore we can write this as minus f times the divergence of V d rho. Okay, and now bringing the right side to the left side, we can also write all this in a shorter form, namely that nabla V f d rho is equal to zero. Good, and now we can use this in the linearized field equations. Let's just do this and assume smoothness. Maybe I should also have put this here in a lemma of the universe. If V and L is smooth, let's assume this also because we don't want to enter these different jet spaces and all of this. Good, now let's write down the linearized field equations. So U Laplace V, so this is Nabla U of the integral over M Nabla 1V plus Nabla 2V acting on the Lagrangian d rho y minus Nabla V S. Good. How can this be simplified? Well, the point is that this term here drops out. Namely, we can integrate by parts, just as I explained here for the function little f. We assume that the inner solution has compact support, therefore we do not get boundary terms, and as a consequence, this term, this derivative here simply goes out. What remains is derivatives acting on x. So this acts on x and this, and we can take them all out of the integral. So therefore what we get is here Nabla U Nabla V L of x, where we again use the convention that all the jet derivative act only on this variable x. In other words, that this jet V here is not differentiated. Okay, and using this convention, of course, all these derivatives here commute, so we can also write it as Nabla V Nabla U L of x. Good. And what we do next is that we write this as Nabla V of Nabla U L of x, and then we subtract the du dv u L of x, where here in the last step we use it somewhat different. We mean something different. I mean, this is a bit, well, one has to be careful because the notation is somehow very dense. So therefore, let me just write for clarity what we mean here. So here, both derivatives act on L, whereas what we mean here is, this is be just an iterated derivative. So this derivative here acts on both L and the jet U. Okay, I don't know if maybe I should clarify this in the notation by writing here Nabla U of X. But generally speaking, I mean, of course, if we clarify the notation here, then it gets longer and we don't want this either. And we only need this at this one point here. So therefore, it's maybe best to just write what we mean. What can we do now? So now we can argue as follows. This Nabla U L of X, this vanishes in space-time as a consequence of the Euler-Lagrange equations. So Nabla U L of x is equal to zero for all x in M due to the Euler-Lagrange equations. So therefore, the function here vanishes identically in space-time. The inner solution here, so this vector field is tangential to space-time. So therefore, the derivative here is a derivative in space-time. So in other words, we differentiate a function which is constant zero, and then the derivative exists and is also zero. And here it is really important that V is tangential to M. This derivative Nabla V of Nabla UL exists on M, well, and as a derivative of a constant function, it is 0. Okay, so therefore the first term here is 0. What about the second term? Well, this is 0 as a consequence of the Euler-Lagrange equations. This nabla dvul is equal to 0 due to the Euler-Lagrange equations. Okay, and this concludes the proof. But only under the additional assumptions, so just to clarify this, we assume first of all that the vector field has compact support and that the Lagrangian is smooth. Well, and of course that space-time is smooth as well as a smooth manifold structure. How can one prove this in general? Let me just briefly explain this. So generalizations. So first of all, if the vector field, if V has no compact support, then the result still holds if V has sufficient decay conditions at infinity. So V has no compact support. But decays suitably at infinity. So, well, intuitively, it's clear what we are doing here. We need to make sure that we do not get boundary terms when integrating by parts. So, if we integrate by parts here, we do not want to pick up boundary terms. Making precise what this means here. What does it mean? How does it need to decay at infinity? What does it mean at infinity and all of that? This is something we have specified, and you see the details in the paper with Nikki Kamran, and you find the link on our website. What about if the Lagrangian is not smooth? Well, then there's a corresponding result where one has to be careful with the different jet spaces. So in other words, this J test has to have certain properties. The vector field has to be certain properties. For example, this derivative which comes up here again has to be in J test and so on. Okay, and again, you find the details in the paper with Nikki Kamran, and I think there's no point in entering this here. Okay, so I think that's all I wanted to say in this video. I hope you liked it, and see you again soon.